Delta Life Table is a declarative framework that is uniquely provided by Databricks that simplifies the creation and management of reliable, maintainable, and testable data pipeline. It is designed to work seamlessly with the Mendelian architecture, which allows us to organize our data into the bronze, silver, and gold layers. So in this video, I'm going to show us how we can create a Delta Life Table pipeline using the SQL language. We're going to also use the star schema data modeling technique. So let's get started. Let's take a look at the sample sales data before we go ahead and upload to the Azure Blob Storage container. So I'm going to come to the CSV file, and I've got this order ID, order date across to the e-commerce column. So we have a total of 10,000 routes. So I'm going to come to the browser, and I can come to the portal.azure.com, and I'm going to open up this Cornerstone Analytics Storage account. So click on that, and then I want to go to containers, and I've got this sales container already created. So I'm going to use the upload functionality and search for the file, which is sales CSV. Click on that, and I'm going to click on open. So we can see the file here. So I can click on upload, and this is going to be ingested into the sales container in my Azure Storage Blob account. Now I'm going to come to the Databricks environment, and I'm going to go ahead and mount our Azure Blob Storage container on top of the DBFS. So I'm going to come, before I go on, I'm going to come to this catalog, and then I'm going to go to the browse DBFS. So I'm going to click on this mount, and when I click on mount, you can see I don't have it. So I'm going to come to the recent, and in the recent, I've got this mount Azure Blob Storage Container notebook. Now in the notebook, we're going to create this blob storage mount point. So we have this dbutils.fs. make directory, and then we're just passing this mnt forward slash blob storage. Now you can use whatever name you like, and then we're going to go ahead and mount the Azure Blob Storage having created the directory points. So for this, we have the dbutils.fs.mount, and then for the argument, we're passing the source, which is equivalent or equal to the name of the container, and then we have to add cornerstoneanalytics.blob.core.windows.net. So this is the name of my storage account, which is exactly what we have here. Can you see? We have Cornerstone Analytics, and then for the mount point, I'm just going to call the MMT forward slash blob storage. Now make sure you have this forward slash, it is really important. And then for the extract configuration, so you have this fs.azure.account key dot cornerstone dot blob dot core dot windows, and I'm going to pass in the account key into this argument. So I'm going to come back here and then go to the security plus networking, click on this access keys, and then I can see the key, we have the one and two. So I'm going to use this, so just copy into the clipboard, come back here within this single quote, I'm going to control V to paste, and then I can press control enter to run the code. Now this is going to return true. And then we can go on and list all the files in this blob storage mount point. So I'm going to press control enter to run this code. And then we can see we have this file info. So we have the path equals to DBFS, and then we have this colon, and then we have this MNT forward slash blob storage forward slash sales data dot CSV. And then we have the name, and then we have the size, and then we have the modification time. So I can come back to the catalog here. I can go to the browse DBFS, click on that, and I can click on MNT, and I can see the blob storage fully mounted. I'm going to click on that, and you can see the sales data.csv, which is now accessible for us. Now I'm going to go ahead and set all our code to perform the DLT pipeline. So I'm going to come to the recent, and in the recent, I've got this Delta Life Table notebook. Now you can actually use whatever language of your comfort. For me, I'm actually more comfortable with SQL. You can use the Python, the PySpark. So I can see the language here, which is absolutely fine. Now we're going to follow the Medallion architecture. We're going to have the bronze, silver, and the gold layers. Now in the bronze, we're going to actually ingest the raw data from the mount point, and then we're going to go to the silver layer, where we're going to clean some data, and then we're going to go to the gold layer, where we're going to have the business ready data. So for the bronze layer, we're going to have this create or refresh life table. Now it is really important you include the life as a keyword here, otherwise this is going to be a regular table. So we have this create or refresh life table, and this is named as bronze cells. So we're going to use the as select. Now we're selecting all the rows or the columns from the data, and then we're going to create the current timestamp. This is named as ingestion time, and then I'm going to just add this input file name, which is named as source. So this is going to be from. Now I'm going to pass in this read underscore files, and then for the argument I'm going to pass in the mount point, and then the format is a comma separated value. Now I'm going to press Control Enter. When I run the code, this is not going to produce a table other than the schema. So we can see we have the bronze sales is defined as a Delta Life tables data set with schema. So we can see the names of the columns and the appropriate data types. Now I'm going to move down to the silver layer. So for the silver layer, now we don't need to pick all the columns. We just need some of the columns that we need to work with, and then we need to perform some cleaning. Now again, we have the create or refresh life table. So this is named as a silver cells. So we're going to use the R select. Now we are selecting the order ID, order date, customer name, account manager, payment type, category, state, product, sales amount, and the ingestion time. And we're going to also extract the year, month number, and the month name, and the week number from the order date. Hence, I've got this year function that is actually extracting the year from this order date column, and this is alias as year, and the same thing for the month number, and so on and so forth. And then we're going to pick that from the intermediate layer, which is the bronze cells. Now it is really important you include a life dot bronze cells here in order for this to work. Afterwards, we're going to have this constraint. So we can see we have this where clause. So we have this where the sales amount column is not null and the sales amount column is greater than zero. Now, upon violation, the rows will be dropped. If the sales amount column is null and if the sales amount is less than zero, it's going to be dropped. And then we have another constraint. So again, we are checking the order ID. We want to make sure that it is not null. And then we want to also make sure that the order ID do not contain a duplicate value. Hence, we have this nested query within this outermost query. So again, we're going to provide the name of the table life.bronze_sales. So this is going to be our silver layer. So I'm going to press Control Enter. Again, this is going to produce the schema, not the table. So we can see we have this order ID and so on and so forth. Now the table has been narrowed down to the specific ones we need. Now we can move to the gold layer. Now in the gold layer, again, I'm going to follow the same convention. We're going to create or refresh live table. So this is named as gold fat sales. Now in this example, we're following the approach of star schema. We're going to have the fact table and the dimension tables. So we can see this is named as gold fact sales. And then we have this comment. And then we have the as select. So we're selecting all of these columns, which is absolutely the same from this level. So this is going to create our fact table for us. And then we're going to go ahead and create our dimension table. Now we're going to create a dimension table called the dim product. So for this, we are just using this, picking this product column. And then we are using this row number window function. And then we have this over clause. And then we are ordering by the product in ascending order. So this is named as product ID. Now this is going to give us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, depending on the number of product we have, unique product. And then from, so we have this innermost query. So this is going to be selecting all the distinct, the unique product from this product column. And then this is going to be coming from live.gold_fact_sales. So this is how we create the dim products. So I'm going to move down. We also have this dim account manager. It follows the same convention with the dim product. And then we have this dim payment type, almost the same in method. And then we have this aggregation, this transformation. Okay, now we have the state, so I'm going to move down. So we have this transformation. So again, we have this create or refresh live table. So we're just calling this one gold_sales by product, account manager, and payment type. So we're just picking all this column, the product, account manager, payment type, and then we're summing the sales amount column, and this is going to be alias as sales total. And then we're going to use the from, so we're going to be picking this from the live.gold_fact_sales, and this is alias as F, and then we're using the inner join to join that with the dim product. So this is named as P. So we can see we have this PA and the PA, and then we have the F and F. And then we're going to use the on keyword to bind the PF dot product equals to P dot product. And then we have the inner join joining that with the dim account manager, and then we have the on keyword F dot account manager equal to A dot account manager, and then we have the third table life.gold dimension table for the payment type, and then we have the on keyword, and then finally we have the group by. So we grouping by all the three columns within our select. Now again, I'm going to press Ctrl Enter to run the code, and it's going to produce this result. Now I'm actually running the code just to make sure that this is actually giving me this insight. Otherwise, if it's giving an error, something is wrong. But with this, I can actually tell that the code is working fine. So this is all the code. Now we can go on and create our Delta Life Table pipeline. Now I'm going to come to under the data engineering, click on the Delta Life Tables, and then we can see under the Delta Life, I've got nothing. So I'm going to click on the create pipeline, and I'm going to give this a meaningful name. I'm going to call this one Sales DLT Pipeline. You can use whatever name you like as usual. And then this is going to be on advanced for the production environment. Now for the pipeline mode, we can use triggered or continuous. So this can run based on the time you specify. And then we will come to the core part, which is the source code. Now we're going to provide the notebook or the file that contains the pipeline source code. Now I can see this path here. Click on this, and it's going to actually open the select source code. Now I'm going to go to my users, and I can see my email, and I'm going to use this Delta Life table that contains all the code I just been showing you not too long. So click on select, and there we go. Now I can even import more than one source code. Just click on add source code and then go ahead and browse. But in our case, I'm going to focus on only this Delta Life table notebook, and then we can scroll down to the next environment. Now we're going to choose the destination. So for the storage option, this can be housed in the Hive Metastore or in our Unity catalog. So this is actually in the preview, and it's going to cost you some money. So I'm going to stick with this Hive Metastore for this demonstration. And then we're going to provide the default schema. I'm going to call this one DLT schema, and this is fine, or DLT. And I'm going to move down to the compute. Now in the compute, we have the cluster policy. I'm going to leave this as none. And then for the cluster mode, I'm going to use the fixed size. I just need a single worker for this demonstration. And then I can even use the Photon acceleration just to enhance the query performance. And then we can also use the notification. Now you can actually send notification upon success, failure, or upon fatal failure. So I can just put in my email address. Now this actually accepts all email address, whether it is Yahoo, Gmail, and so on and so forth. Now I'm going to choose the unsuccess, or if it fails, no worries, just give me the notification. And then we have the advanced tab. You can just do all of this. So I'm going to click on this create. So as soon as I click on this, I'm going to see this sales DLT pipeline, this environment, and we can see this kebab. In the kebab, we can delete, we can also view the settings in the YAML, and then we have the development, the production, and then you can click on the settings. Now in the settings, it's going to take you back to this environment. If you want to actually make some changes, like you want to rename the pipeline, you want to change the pipeline mode, and so on and so forth. And then once you're done, click on save. And then this is going to take you back to this environment. And now we need to kickstart the pipeline in order for the job to start. So click on the start. And as soon as I click on that, we can see success starting pipeline saves DLT pipeline. And then we can see this is going to start creating updates, and it's going to move to the resource allocation, and it's going to start initializing, and it's going to set up the tables and render the graph. Now this is going to take some minutes, about 5 to 10 minutes, so I'm going to pause the video and continue. Welcome back. So we can see the DLT pipeline completed successfully, so there was no error whatsoever. And I can move this up a little bit, and then we can see all of the event logs. So we can see the number of minutes, and then we have all the information. So everything is absolutely fantastic. I'm going to move this down a little bit, and then we can see the graph. Now before we come to the graph, on the right hand side we have the pipeline details, we have the pipeline ID, the type, which is ELT pattern, and then we have the source code, which is coming from this location, and this is the name of the person that executed, myself, Abiola. So you can come to the update, and in the update we have the update ID, update status, which is completed. If it failed, you're going to see failed here, and then we have the updates and so on and so forth. Now I can click on this to collapse, and then we have the graph. Now this looks a little bit tiny. You can click on this to, you know, move it up a little bit, to just, you know, bump it up. Now we can see we have the materialized view. So from this point, which is the bronze layer, we have completed, so we have a total of 10,000 records. And then for the silver layer, it's actually decreased to 3,200. And then In the gold layer, we have the same number of data or records. And this is where we have a lot of activities. So we can see the different dimension table we created. So when you move your cursor, you can see this is the DIM account manager. So this is producing 14. We have a total of 14 account managers. And then when I move to this, this is the DIM payment type. So this tells you that we have 13 payment types. And then when I come to this, so this is going to produce the DIM products. We have a total of 9 products. And then when I come to this, so we have the DIM state, we have a total of 49 states. And this is where we have our calculation. So we can see how the graph is actually flowing from this gold layer, across to this and then across the dimension table. So this is absolutely fantastic. Now I'm going to come to my catalog. Now don't forget, this data is actually going to be stored in our Hive metastore. So I can see this actually under the legacy. Click on this to expand, and then I can see the DLT underscore schema that we created. Click on that to expand, and then we can see the bronze cells. When I click on that, I can see the overview. We have these columns, and then I can just click on this, and then we have the entire data set that we ingested from the mount point, which is fine. And then we have the silver layer, and then in the silver, this is where we just pick some number of columns that we needed, and then we transform the data. And then we have the gold layer, the fact cells, the fact table. And then we have the DIM state, the DIM products, and so on and so forth. Now we can use all of these in our dashboard. For example, I can click on this. So this can be used in Tableau desktop. It can also be used in Power BI desktop and also in Power BI service, the workspace, which is absolutely fantastic. Now, if there's anything you want to do, maybe you want to click on this kebab, you can always delete. So this is how we can implement a Delta Live table in Databricks. I trust you enjoyed this video. If you do, like, comment, and follow me for more videos. Thank you for watching. Bye for now.